Hello and welcome back to another video with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be learning about gas law stoichiometry. In this two-part video, in part one, we are going to be going over STP-related gas law stoichiometry equations, meaning that STP is what we refer to as a standardized temperature and pressure. If you are interested in part two, that's going to be looking more specifically at how to use the ideal gas law, referring to when we have a chemical equation for both of them, when it's balanced, which scenario can you apply? So to make this video a little bit shorter, I split into two parts. So if you're interested in one versus the other, please go check them both out. All right, so we're first going to start with the STP version of this video. First thing is we're going to be looking at the two different types of problems that you'll see with gas laws. As you may remember from gas laws, is that there are dozens of formulas, it feels like. But the good news is you really only need to know about two different types, which is looking at the word problem and dissecting it correctly, which we're going to go through the tips and tricks of how to decipher these, especially if you're struggling in general chemistry. So look at the different problems and you can sort, go by chapter to really down below when you scroll to help you go to the problem you need help with. Now with this STP, just as a reminder, that's when you have the standard temperature and pressure, meaning that all the conditions are defined for you, right? Temperature is 273 Kelvin, pressure is 1 atmosphere, and we also have access to the molar volume, which means that 22.4 liters of any gas is equivalent to 1 mole of a gas. Now, if it's not at STP, or even if it is, you still could use the ideal gas law. But when it comes to the ideal gas law, this is always referring to what the current condition is of the gas after the reaction occurred, or even before the reaction occurred. So what is the condition? Now, the big thing about this is you have four different variables, which are pressure, volume, temperature, and moles. You need three out of four of these to be able to use this formula, or it can get a little bit tricky and a little complicated. So generally, you're always given three out of the four. So when we are looking at these, we are going to be exploring all the different formulas in many different problems. So let's take a look at how to use these, starting with STP. Now, when it comes to stoichiometry, the whole idea is that this is all about unit cancellation. So same thing as dimensional analysis and most of the conversions you do in chemistry. Now, the thing with stoichiometry is that generally it uses a balanced chemical equation. But what we're going to start with is some problems that don't involve a chemical equation, just to get some of the basics to remind us of unit cancellation. So the first problem here is how many moles of neon are in 6 liters of gas at STP? Well, with this problem, you are still doing unit cancellation, but you're involving moles, which is still talking about how we can read these problems. So the first thing is, if we notice, is that it starts with a given number. Always write down your numeric values. 9 times out of 10, they are important. So we have 6 liters. Now, being that this is a STP, what we can use is that molar volume, which was 22.4 liters, is equivalent to 1 mole. So being that we can use that, we want to cancel our units. So being that we have liters on top, that means we need liters also on the bottom here. So 22.4 liters. We now see that, oh, our units are going to cancel, which is fantastic. And that's equivalent to 1 mole. So what does this mean as a little T table? If this is your first time seeing these, is you do 6 divided by 22.4 and you will get your number here. So what we are going to get is 0.268 moles. But being that we started with two significant figures, so we can see that up here, there's two digits. We are going to round this to 0.27 moles. All right, let's take a look at the next one. So what if I want to do the other way? So how many liters would 2.4 moles of argon occupy at STP? Well, same idea, right? If I have 2.4 moles, that's going to be on top. We will put 1 mole on the bottom, 22.4 liters on top. And what we can once again see is, hey, mole, mole, cancel. So we now have 2.4. times 22.4, and as a result, what we are going to get is 53.76 liters, and we are going to once again round that to two sig figs, so we are going to get 54 liters. Okay. And when we're done, we want to box our answer off, just like I did, should have did earlier. And that is how you do it with just how to use the STP conversion. Let's take a look at some chemical equations. Now, when we work with STP, it is really important that you realize when it is a STP. Generally, it's always listed in the problem that we have it. So even though I have the title above, so you can see it in the problem too. So it says calculate the volume in liters of ammonia produced when 5.5 liters of H2 react with excess N2 at STP. Okay, so we have this thing that says STP. That's really important. That means your problem is 10 times easier. You do not have to use the ideal gas law. There are some other key pieces of information too, right? We were given the number, we have the number of liters of hydrogen, and it tells us we have excess nitrogen, meaning that it doesn't run out. So it only has to rely on hydrogen. This is not a limiting reactant problem, which is great, right? You'd have to have both values to have that. Now, the one thing is, if you kind of notice, there's not a chemical equation, so what you have to do is predict and balance it, which tends to be a really common theme in a lot of these. So one thing it says is how much ammonia is produced in the problem, right? So kind of highlight that in purple right there. So when it says it's produced or made or created, synthesized, oxidized, all these different terms referring to a reaction, generally that's probably the product. So you got to read it carefully. Sometimes it depends on how everything's worded. But if it says it's made, that's a sign that, hey, this has to be on the product side. All right. So now it also says that hydrogen and ammonia reacted, right? So we were given that volume, that excess. So let's put those over here just so we have that. So H2 plus N2. All right. Now, how do we balance this? Well, generally, when it comes to balancing this problem, is that you notice that we have an odd number of hydrogens here on the right-hand side. When you have an odd subscript, this is something I like to always want to try first, is even the odds, right? So what does that mean? Well, we don't like odd numbers. So let's make it even. So let's add a coefficient in front of that of 2. Now, what does that do? That makes a total of 6 hydrogens on the right. So what we are now going to do is put a 3 in front of the hydrogens on the left, meaning we have 6 hydrogens on the left and on the right. And one thing you might have noticed as along with that is how many nitrogens do you now have? Well, you have 2 nitrogens now on the left, and you already had 2 on the right. So it is balanced and it is happy. This is exactly what we want. All right. So now that we have that, what we are going to do now is use the piece of information that was given to us in the problem, which, as you saw, we had 5.5 liters of hydrogen, and that is at STP. So let's kind of write that down. So what we also are trying to figure out as well is how much ammonia was produced. So we have to use our chemical reaction. So the first thing what we have was that 5.5 liters, right, of H2. And this is where it's really important that you're kind of writing out all your different units, all your species, so that way you're not getting them like mixed up when you're showing them, because the molecules have to cancel too. So one thing about this is that you see, okay, if you remember our relationship we had, 22.4 liters is equivalent to 1 mole of hydrogen, right? So we'll write hydrogen for both these. And we see that liters of hydrogen cancels liters of hydrogen. Now that we have moles, right, your goal is always the mole. If you can get there, you're half of the way there, so which is fantastic. And we want to get to ammonia. So what we now need to do is read our chemical equation, which you can see 3 moles of hydrogen is equivalent to 2 moles of ammonia. So what we are going to do is we're going to write our 3 moles of hydrogen on the bottom. Reason is because now you can see that, hey, your units now cancel. And now we're going to put 2 moles of ammonia on top, okay? And then we're going to finish it with that that molar volume once again, right? So we're 1 mole of NH3. Remember, any gas is equivalent to 22.4 liters of NH3. And the last thing is, you can see once again, units cancel here as well, which is awesome. Now, the thing about this problem is that you might notice something if you are math savvy, is that there is more to this than a can't stop other than the units. One thing you'll see is that the 22.4 liters down here are on top here, cancels the 22.4 liters all the way on the other side, right? There's many different things that can cancel. Same thing with 1 mole and 1 mole all the way across. So wait a minute, can this problem be a lot easier? And the answer is absolutely it can. So everything's cleaned up. Now what we can actually do is when the problem is at STP, you can use the coefficients to define a liter to liter ratio. So meaning that going off our chemical formula is that 2 liters of ammonia is equivalent to 3 liters of hydrogen. And that's because of kinetic molecular theory. All the gases are indiscriminate particles that you can't tell the difference between. So there is a relationship between them. So you'll get the exact same answer. So all we have to do is do 5.5, divide by 3, multiply by 2, and what we will get is 3.7 liters of ammonia. So you can kind of, you can ignore all that craziness of that long problem. So this is when it is at STP that you can do this step for a volume to volume. It's nice to know the little tricks because it can save you a lot of time on exams that you're limited on your time. Let's look at another. Stoichiometry at STP. So if you have a chemical equation, you generally will have to do some stoichiometry, meaning that we're going to have to use the mole-to-mole volume very often. So with this problem, the metabolic oxidation of glucose, C6H12O6, in our bodies produces CO2, which is expelled through our lungs as a gas, right? You breathe out. So if I have, let's say, the following chemical formula, which is C6H12O6, glucose, which is combining with oxygen to make CO2 and water. Calculate the volume of oxygen required to oxidize 50 grams of glucose at STP. Wow, that was a lot of information in one thing, but it all really boils down to just knowing the chemical equation and this last line. So what do we need, right? We want the volume, and we started with 50 grams of glucose, and that's at STP, which is very, very crucial. So how do we start? Well, remember, the goal is always the mole, right? How can you get something here to moles? Well, you got to kind of think, going through your chemist toolbox, what can you convert? You have pretty much available to you are 3 options. You have molar mass, the ideal gas law, or you can essentially use molarity. Well, there's no molarity here, and you don't have all of the variables for the ideal gas law. You have temperature, pressure. Remember, you need 3 out of 4. You don't have everything. But you do have the essentially glucose here, which is its mass. You can always look up the molar mass via your periodic table. So if we are to do that, let's say if we are to get the molar mass for glucose, so meaning you're going to take 6 carbons, multiply it by 12.011, then you're going to add that plus 12 hydrogens, and they're each 1.008, and then add that by the 6 oxygens, you will get 180.156 grams of glucose is equivalent to 1 mole, okay, of glucose. Now, from that, what can you do from there? Well, being that we are curious about how much, what calculate the volume of oxygen here, we can now do the mole-to-mole ratio from the problem, right? This is where the stoichiometry comes from. You can see that for every 6 moles of O2, there is 1 mole of C6H12O6 or glucose to the equivalent. So it's 1 mole, and we'll put C6H12O6 for every 6 moles of O2, right? They're equivalent to one another. So now when that happens, you can see grams cancels grams, our moles of glucose cancels our moles of glucose, and we're left with only our moles of O2. So we want to check that off. Our units all canceled. We're good, right? So if we were plug this in our calculator, we'll do 50 times 6 and then divide that by 180.156. That will give us how many moles we have. Now, is that everything? Are we done? Well, the thing is, it wants volume. So what can I do now? Well, if you remember, STP, right? So we can do one more step. We can use our STP, our molar volume, to do the last step. So we got to our goal, but we want to go one more step. So 1 mole of O2 is now, it's going to be equivalent to 22.4 liters of gas. All right. Now, if you put now that into your calculator, what you are going to get is 37.3 liters of oxygen gas is going to be produced when you oxidize the 50 grams worth of sugar. Thank you so much for listening to part one of this video. So in this video, as you saw, we went through the STP versions of how to look at gas law stoichiometry. In part two, we will look at how to apply the ideal gas law. So please check out part two following up. You should be seeing that recommendation right over my face in a second. So thank you so much for listening. I hope this video helped you. Please stop by again. If you have any questions, please message me, reach out to me. Comment below on the video. If this is your first time here, please like and subscribe to the channel. Please keep helping it grow and help me help more students just like you. All right. Thank you all, and I hope you have a wonderful day.